Hi, this is Judith Bourque, and I'm so happy to have the opportunity to read my book for you. I'm in my studio located in the Sofo district of Stockholm, and it's summer. So you might hear some seagulls or other birds calling in the background. Thank you for sharing my journey. This book is dedicated to my son Jonathan and my grandchildren, Lucia and Amos. Preface. This book is the story of a love affair kept secret. A secret I really thought would follow me to my grave or to my ashes, whichever way I leave. I was sure that the whole experience was behind me, that I had digested it, and if not completely understood it, that I could comfortably just leave it alone, the past not being that interesting to me anymore. It was the now that was important. And yet, here we are, 180 degrees in the opposite direction. It all started because of a dream. Not a dream of wishes and hopes, but a dream during sleep where the man whom I had loved in my youth came to me with a message. His name was Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, a spiritual teacher who was a guru for the Beatles, Clint Eastwood, David Lynch, Deepak Chopra, Donovan, Jerry Seinfeld, Mia Farrow, Mike Love, Paul Horn, and a whole slew of other well-known personalities, as well as for 6 million meditators spread out across the globe. 3 years passed before I understood the message in my dream fully. During that time, Maharishi had died and been cremated on the banks of the River Ganges, his ashes thrown into her holy waters. What happened next was that a German filmmaker, David Sivaking, having heard rumors about Maharishi breaking his vows in secrecy, succeeded in finding me. Maharishi's teachings had touched David Sivaking's life through his admiration for meditating film director David Lynch, and that contact led him on a spiritual journey documented in the film he was making. It was not until David, with polite persistence, convinced me that his approach in the documentary would be one of balance, neither total condemnation of Maharishi nor fanatical idealization, did I start even to consider speaking publicly of this matter. David's request made me start to waver, but I was still very unsure. After all, I'd been silent for the entirety of my adult life to the point where the silence had simply become a part of who I was, or who I thought I was. Even though Maharishi had died, the thought of actually telling my story was still very upsetting and very confusing. In the hopes of finding some clarity, I booked a channeled session with a spiritual counselor, and it was this session that helped me to fully understand the message in my dream. Yes, it was time to take the relationship out of the closet. It wasn't just perhaps a good thing to do. It was in fact the right thing to do, not only for myself, but for Maharishi as well. The details of that session are written down further on in the text, but for now I will say that when I finally took up my pen to share my story with you, I no longer felt afraid or uncertain. Chapter 1. Maharishi and Me at the Berlin Film Festival. Oh God, I'm late. I can't be late. I even left early so I wouldn't be late. Where's the movie theater? Oh my God, this is the wrong movie theater. Ms. Spaghetti, that's what my energy feels like in trying to fit into a societal timeline. In Sweden, where I live now, being on time is a cultural virtue. Sometimes clients will come late to a booked appointment with their hearts in their throats, panting and sweating. I always tell them how much I love it when they're late, since I'm always late myself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.